be able to get here in time for the meeting tonight. So, as David said, what I'll do is talk for a few minutes about the referendum we've got coming up, the reasons why I believe that we should vote to stay inside the European Union, and then very happily we'll take questions. As we said, I'm the Labour member of the European Parliament for Cornwall and the rest of the South West and Gibraltar, and I was elected in May 2014. But before that, for 20 years, I was a trade union official. And it was because of my experiences as a trade union official and the amount of times that I relied on European legislation to help protect the people I was there to represent, and indeed in some instances advance the causes of people in workplaces, that I wanted to become a member of the European Parliament and hopefully continue to support the social work that happens at a European level as opposed to Westminster as an objective. As I say, I'm going to talk about the reasons why I believe we should stay in the European Union. They come, in my view, under three broad headings. The first one is the kind of pragmatic case for our continued membership, which are those benefits that we get because we're part of the EU. The second one is our place in the world as a consequence of our membership of the EU. And the third one is points of principle as to why we should continue in the European Union. On the pragmatic basis, then, as I mentioned just now, that personal perspective of the benefits of the European Union. So, as a trade unionist, the ones that are very close to my heart are the points about the right to paid leave, the right to breaks between shifts, the right to protection if you're a pregnant worker, the right to equal pay. The list is pretty extensive of those benefits. Actually, protections, health and safety protections at work. And if you were to believe the Daily Mail about bureaucracy and red tape, well, I can absolutely guarantee that those health and safety rights are not bureaucracy. They are not red tape. They are things that protect people's limbs, they protect people's lives in the workplace, and they protect them from long-term industrial diseases as well. So as opposed to those instant impacts, it's also those longer-term consequences that actually we have protection from because of our European Union membership. And those protections are things that cannot be taken away from us if we get a change of government. And that is in Westminster, and that's really, really important. I could go on at great length about those, but I'll park those for the moment. A second area where we get those pragmatic benefits, and again one that matters here, but also around the rest of the region, are environmental protections. And I'm doing an event tomorrow by Whitsun Bay, which is on beaches. Beach parties are happening around the country. We're doing one there tomorrow. But they are because of the difference that European legislation has made to the quality of our water, they've made to the quality of our beaches. I used to come down here when I was a child. I used to come stay near Dyke Tyne Dreth, and later on worked on the farm that we used to stay on. But I remember vividly the streams and rivers running white because of the China clay, and the what came out from the China clay factories was going into the water here. And of course, we don't have that anymore. And although it's quite a romantic memory, it was actually doing a lot of damage to the environment, and we now have that protection because of our membership of the European Union. But it has to be said as well, standing in Cornwall and talking about pragmatic benefits, that Cornwall specifically benefits from those from our membership of the European Union. There will be 500 million just in this spending period alone that is dedicated to projects in Cornwall before 2020. And in fact, over the period that Cornwall has had this status within the European Union, it will have received £2 billion worth of investment. And I know the people that want us to leave, and some of them from this county, are going around saying that well, we could, we, you know, the money that we don't send to Europe, they're a little disingenuous, I think, is the kindest way I've been about the money that we do send to Europe, because they've sort of vastly inflated it. But, you know, that would be spent in Cornwall anyway. I see absolutely no evidence of UK Treasury spending that money in Cornwall if it weren't coming to us from the European Union. You just have to look at decisions that the Treasury have made to be fairly confident that we wouldn't be getting the level of investment that we're seeing from European Union funding from the UK Treasury would not substitute that money directly. So, you know, that's a very particular benefit that happens in Cornwall. We were talking about that in terms of the direct impact on people's lives, that it has transformed people's lives here, as well as the infrastructure. Also, when we're talking about, and I mentioned the environment, you know, in terms of those practical reasons for why we should continue inside the European Union, it is absolutely about making legislation that is made at the right level to deliver the outcomes that we need. And there are issues that we now face in a globalised world that we are most effectively going to be able to deal with at that European Union level. An obvious one that springs to mind is the issue of climate change. And we have seen directly, climate change is not something that is just impacting on islands that are a few inches above ocean level in the Pacific. Although clearly we have to be concerned, we should be concerned about those impacts. But the Met Office in the next county, in Exeter, the scientists there, climate change scientists, are very, very clear that the additional rainfall, the intensity of rainfall that we have been seeing in this country over recent years is as a consequence of climate change. The storm damage that we suffered, the change in our weather patterns, that is as a consequence of climate change. But we're not going to be able to solve or address climate change within
That's fine.
We are going to be able to most effectively put in place measures that at a European level. And we saw that being done on a practical basis at the climate change conference in Paris just before Christmas, where there was an ambitious in a way that we would never have hoped for after the Copenhagen talks, the previous seven talks in 2009, which, for any of you that remember it, were pretty depressing. And the reason we saw that goal of 2 degrees above pre-industrial temperatures, and in fact an aim for 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial temperatures, and benchmarks against which we have to be measured in terms of achieving that goal. The reason we saw that is because the EU took a leading role and pulled together a coalition of the willing as well to increase, not only, as I say, to come to the agreement that was reached in December, but also that we will keep revisiting it. It wasn't a full stop. It was a comma in terms of the work that has to be done to address climate change. And the final point I would put under this kind of pragmatic point about legislating at the right level is that we are seeing, as I say, in this globalised world,
the fact that companies are moving their profits around cross border. And again, that is something that is actually very difficult to deal with at a national level. We're seeing it's difficult to deal with at a national level. But we are taking action at a European level. So we are making it so that companies have to open up their books and be much more transparent about what profits they are making in which companies. And we have seen, you know, various companies, Google being one example, but you know, various coffee chains that apparently have not been making a profit in this company for a number of years, according to their tax returns. Well, you know, that is something we have to take action on, but we are most effective at taking action on at a European level. Because these companies are benefiting from the public services that other companies and people are contributing to. They are benefiting from our NHS, they are benefiting from our education system because their work is a benefiting point. They're benefiting from our roads and our infrastructure, so they damn well should be paying that contribution to our society. And that is why we are taking action at a European level, and that is why it would be more effective to have that action at a European level as well. So those are, as I say, a quick trot around just some of the pragmatic benefits. There are a load more. There are consumer benefits. There are all sorts of benefits that we get in so many areas. And I haven't even talked about trade and jobs as well, and the impacts and the benefits that we get from our European Union membership. Moving on, though, to our place in the world, this is about our standing in our neighbourhood. Today there was another world leader leader of another country that said supporting our continued membership of the European Union, which was the Indian Prime Minister. But we've seen leaders from the US to Tokyo saying Britain is a more significant player on the global stage from within the European Union than if we leave the European Union. And that, I think that's an infallible truth in the sense of what is our view of ourselves? If our view of ourselves is that we don't have a central role to play in our own neighbourhood, then why do we think the rest of the world would think we have a central role to play in the rest of the world? We are hugely important inside the European Union. We are one of the three countries without whom nothing happens. We can stop things happening, we can make things happen at a European Union level. And it is us, France and Germany, that are the three significant countries. And that is why when I talk to people from outside the UK, be it my colleagues in the European Parliament or other people from around the rest of Europe, or indeed people from outside of Europe, their initial reaction to our referendum is to think we have taken leave of our senses, leaving the European Union, where we are so central. And other colleagues in Europe, that is absolutely, it's kind of you are hugely important inside the EU. Why would you give up that role inside the EU? But also, we already have opt-outs from so much of the legislation in the EU as well, so it's not as if we haven't already been given a different position inside the EU. But it is that standing that we need, our view of ourselves. If we are an international nation, then surely that means we work with our closest neighbours. It isn't as if the rest of the world is going, oh, if only you weren't inside the EU, we'd have a better relationship with you. Or if we were looking at it from a trade perspective, if only we weren't inside the EU, we could trade much more with other places around the world. Doesn't apply to Germany. Germany trades three or four times as much as we do with places like China.